Friday last May in the suburb of Newtown, Marika came home from school. It was a day just like any other day. But her father was flat out serving and barely noticed her. She went through the shop, up the stairs, along the passageway, and into Yaya's room. And suddenly the day was dark and different. The blinds were down, the light was off, and the black shape of Yaya was propped up in front of the dressing table mirror. She was so still and stiff. Now, how would Mama feel about all this? I wonder if she'd go straight over to Yaya to see if Yaya was all right. No. I think her first reaction would be Mama was shaking Marika, angry because she'd been given such a fright. And what about Marika? How would she feel in this moment? Marika felt an awful idiot, standing there in the middle of the catastrophe that she'd set in motion.
I'm sorry. I came in and she looked dead.
Marika felt hot and red and silly.
That's terrific, Nadia. A great way to start a story.
Who are you?
You know.
Oh, so that's what you look like.
What did you think I'd look like?
Just like you, I suppose.
If it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't exist.
Yeah, and then there wouldn't be any story.
What made you decide to write the story?
It was one Easter, a few years ago, when I was living in Greece. Even though I'm Australian, I lived in Greece for a while. Do you see that house over there, the one with the green shutters? That's where I was living when I wrote the story. Actually, in that little room there.
It's a Venetian mansion, and it must have been, oh, maybe 400 years old. A friend came to stay from Australia. She was a children's librarian, and she complained that she didn't have any books to give the Greek children who came into the library. Also, there were no books about Greece for the Australian children.
So I thought to myself, why don't I write one? And I tried to think what would make a good story, and then suddenly I had this idea that I'd write a story about a yaya. Do you know what that is? That's what Greeks call their grannies. And in my story, this yaya has a little granddaughter who's called Marika.
And you had an inspiration about Marika getting a goat for her yaya.
Well, partly, but writing really isn't just about the inspirations. Once you get the idea, then you've got to work it all out.
And anyway, what about Marika? I mean, how did you dream me up? How did you decide that I was going to be a girl like me and live with my family in Newtown and have a yaya and a brother called Costa and live in a corner shop in Smith Street and all those sorts of things?
I guess it happened because I used to live in Newtown for a long time and I knew lots of little girls like you or like Marika.
I became friendly with this little boy in the deli in my street. And it was through him that I realised how hard a lot of the Greek children in Australia work. And so somehow out of that, I got the idea of Marika working in the shop, I think. From the beginning of living in Newtown, I really loved it. It's a very busy, very crowded inner city suburb. Nowadays, some of the houses are getting done up, but it was very dilapidated 10 years ago. When I first lived there. Sometimes the things you imagine are more real than real things, aren't they? Yes, Marika's yaya.
Scone.
are.
Randall saw you something.
What do you mean, welcome? I live here. Yeah, okay. You live here too now because you're in the book. Why did I put you in the book? Because I used to see you sitting on the porch over there all day, all by yourself, with nothing to do. You used to look so lonely, just sitting there. I got to wondering what it was like to be a yaya. I wondered what you used to think about all day. I didn't know how to say hello. I didn't know what to do. No, I'm not Greek. But I lived there for 3 years. And I used to see lots of yayas. They were so different from the yayas in Australia. In Greece they were strong and they were busy and they were respected. They used to boss me around. They used to laugh, quite friendlily, and they called me the silly foreign girl. And anything I did, such as try to milk a goat, or pull out thistles, or gather herbs, they'd think I did in the wrong way, and immediately come to help, or show me how.
She hasn't got any milk. Oh, that explains it, I suppose.
Every so often, Yaya would allow Marika to drag her out for a slightly longer walk around the streets of Newtown. But for the most part, Yaya's territory had shrunk to the small dark room where the icons gleamed oddly on the cracked white wall. If only she got out and about, Marika was thinking now, she'd learn to handle traffic and she'd see things and people and come to life again. But without anything to do out there in the world and without any friends outside her own family, but without anything to do out there in the world, there was no reason for Yaya to go out. That reads much better.
What about me?
Oh, you're back, are you?
Yeah. Listen, I don't have any friends in the story either. How about giving me a friend? A special friend.
What sort of friend would you like?
How about... She's perfect.
Do you really think that's the sort of friend Marika would have?
Maybe I should have an Australian friend. Maybe I should try and fit in with the Australians. Try to make them accept me more. How about this one? She's more like it.
Don't you think you might feel a bit funny taking her home to your family?
I guess you're right. Sorry, girls.
Look, I know it'd be nice for you to have a friend, but I think Marika's a lonely little girl who finds it hard to make friends, and that's why she spends so much time with her yaya. I'm sorry, but the characters really do have to fit in with the story. You know, when I was a little girl, I didn't really have many friends either. Now, let me see. By now we know all our main characters, and we know that Yaya's really homesick for Greece and that Marika's worried about Yaya. And then here in chapter 2, Marika has a brainwave.
She realises that Yaya needs something to do. She needs a job.
Great.
sorry.
Could I have a frozen pizza and a frozen chicken chow mein?
Hey, what about this grape picking ad? You could have your Yaga off to Hunter Valley to pick grapes. And Marika could visit her in the school holidays. And your Yaga could organise a big Greek wine festival.
I don't think your Yaga would do such a thing.
Oh, why not?
It's just not part of a character. In the story, Yara is a lonely woman who sits in the house all day with nothing to do. She'd hardly go off to the Hunter Valley all on her own and ring up hundreds of people and organise a wine festival.
I guess you're right.
Now, what do we know about Yara? This is her photograph album. See? That was your dad. And there he is down on the phone.
Βλέπεις, Μαρία, βλέπεις την πόπη μου. Η κατσίκα που είχα στο χωριό έβγαζε το καλύτερο γάλα στα τρία πλατάνια. Μα εσύ, πού να τη θυμάσαι.
Πού τα φέρω εγώ, γιαγιά.
Όχι. Θέλω να το κρατήσω.
Γιαγιά, you know the photo will only make it worse. Now put it away.
Got any bright ideas?
No.
A ghost! Marika was all whirly in the head, like you are when you get a real brainwave. A goat, a goat, a goat for ya, ya. The words took off by themselves, dancing mad circles in Marika's head. Marika felt herself flung around by them, overtaken by their rhythm. Yaya could be a goat herder again. Yaya could make cheese and they'd sell it in the shop. She'd be out and about, leading the goat to pasture and milking her and everything. With a goat in the yard, Newtown would be just like her home in Crete. How will they feel about her getting a goat?
They'll think it's terrific. They'll be so pleased that Yaya won't be lonely anymore, that she'll have something to do every day.
A goat in Newtown! And you will graze it on the railway line, I suppose. And you'll be buying a goat that feeds on bricks and concrete? Since when do Aussies have goats? Tell me, do you see John Lawrence for a goat? Or Ned Kelly? Do you think Farlap was a goat? In case you haven't noticed, I have a business to run. I can't afford to be a freak.
I could have told you he wouldn't have a bar of it.
But lucky for me, Marika's not the sort of girl who gives up easily. I think she'll find a way. What are you doing?
Mowing. Because I haven't got a lawnmower. I don't really need a lawnmower. There's not enough lawn. Besides, I can't stand the damn noise they make. That's one thing I like about living around here. Nobody's got a lawnmower.
You need a goat!
Why?
To mow the lawn!
Have you got one?
No, but I'm getting one.
A goat mower, eh?
Yes! Everyone who had a lawn in Newtown could use it.
Well, let's see. If, say, there are 100 houses in Newtown, each with a lawn area of, say, 4 metres by 2 metres, that equals a total lawn area of 800 square metres. Now, if a goat needs, say, 20 square metres a day of lawn, then that, well, that's enough for each house with one goat every month. Oh, it's really quite feasible for Marika to have a goat in Newtown.
Oh, so you're here, Wayne, all the way from Boston.
Well, I thought you might need help with a problem or two.
Yeah, what Marika has to do now is raise the money to get the goat.
Oh, well, I see here in chapter 10 you've got Marika going for a job as a delivery boy.
And here in chapter 11, a neighbour comes up with a bright idea, a fate to raise the money.
Ah, right, they have a fate. Oh, yes, I got your letter.
Yes, I wanted to check up on some of the things I wanted to have in the fate. I remember an experiment you used to do a few years ago when you were living here.
Dear Wayne, I'm writing a children's book called Five Times Dizzy, and it's ended up having a character very much like you, who I've called the Professor. In the story, there's a bit where they have a fate, and at the fate, I have the Professor doing experiments. Remember the one you used to do with the watermelon? Ladies and gentlemen, you are about to witness one of the most extraordinary spectacles of nature, the amazing exploding watermelon trick. First of all, you take one perfectly simple ordinary watermelon. See that, madam? If you haven't got one, you can buy one. They're on special at Nick's Deli this week. Place it on the centre of the table. Next, we take one pinch of the magic powder. Now, if you don't have any magic powder, you can always use sugar. It's also on special at Nick's Deli. We sprinkle the magic powder over the watermelon. We stand well back. Say the magic word. Hydrochlorosulfuroamylacetate. And
but the best thing at the fate was the haunted house. In that, there was a ghost chamber and a skeleton room, a spider maze, a creeper walk, and the doom dungeon.
So, the fate's a great success. And they raise the money and Yaya gets her.
But that's not the end of the story. Too Greek. They say there aren't enough Greek readers in Australia to make it worthwhile.
Greeks? It's not for the Greeks, it's for the Australians.
But the story was there, and it had to be told.
And it was told.
Yeah. Finally, after a few more rejections, a publisher did publish it, and it became a book called Five Times Dizzy.